in computer science education, and I'm here to help teach you about how to program an app inventor, which is super fun. And then we also have Gerald.
Yeah, my name is Gerald, and I am a fourth year graduate student in computer sciences, and I'm also doing an interdisciplinary PhD in computer sciences and education. And I'm also here to just like show you guys like how cool computer science is, and to really show you how what are the fun things that you can do if you know computer science or if you learn programming.
Yeah. So I'd like to go around and have you say your name and why you are here today, so we get a sense of who's in the room. We're going to be working together some throughout this workshop. So, want to start?
Sure. I'm Erica. I'm actually volunteering here today. So if you're stuck at a certain backing up. I'm a master's student in computer science. I just actually started. If you're stuck at a certain part or whatnot, you can just raise your hand or holler at me and I can come around and see if we can get you unstuck.
All right.
So yeah.
Great. Thank you for being here.
Sure. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Megan and I'm a first year graduate student and I'm studying computer science introductory course this year. So that's why.
Rachel, and I'm a senior, and I'm getting a certificate in science.
Okay.
Cool.
So yeah. Okay. Hi, I'm Kara. I actually work at Epic in Verona. I've been there for 8 years, and I wanted to take this course since I know nothing about coding or computer science, and I want to see if it would be something that would be cool to bring to Epic and have our developers teach other people like me who don't know anything about how to do development.
Hi, I'm Muhammad. I'm a first year undergrad student who are intending to take computer science as a major.
Hi, I'm Alisa. I'm studying business, but I feel like learning more about computer science would be beneficial for me in the future. So.
Hi, I'm Nick. I'm a fourth year senior in computer science and computer engineering, and I'm also here to assist with the workshop.
Hello, I'm Shelly. I'm a freshman. Science 302 this
semester,
and I'm interested in developing the apps software.
I'm Justin, I'm also a freshman. I want to double major in computer engineering, computer science, and just always thought Apple Help was fun.
Awesome. Well, and then, hi guys, I'm Kitna. I'm a second year graduate student, and I'm going to
want to do an academic. Yeah. So, what we're going to do today is we are going to teach you how to use the App Inventor, which is this really awesome free app development environment that is being developed out of MIT. We'll teach you how to use it in the basics, and then we're going to take you through creating two apps of your own. The first one is an app that talks, that's really fun, and the second one is one that lets you take pictures of your friends and like draw on their faces. That's also a lot of fun. The cool thing about App Inventor is not only is it free, but if you have an Android device, you can run these apps on your Android device at home automatically from the beginning. We have for you today some Android devices, some tablets that you guys can use that should already be logged in and have the App Inventor software installed. But we will have a handout for you on how to install the software on your own Android devices, or if you don't have an Android device, how to install what's called an emulator so that you can still run your apps and show it off to your friends what you made. So we'll have that on the handout. If you have your own laptop here, use your own laptop today. It's just a website that you'll be going to. If you don't have a laptop, we do have a couple of spares, but the laptops in this lab don't work because they're on a different internet and they won't connect correctly. So we'll have you use your own. And we're handing out where there's a sign-up sheet that's going around so we can know who's here. And then we're handing out a thing that takes the overview and takes you through how to get started.
Well, my friend doesn't have her own laptop.
Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't bring
so we've
mine.
Got, we have extra laptops. Is there anyone else who needs a laptop? No? All right. Yeah, we brought some just in case. There you go. And it should have enough battery, but let me know if the battery starts running down. We have power cords. All right. So to get us started, we're going to have Gerald take us through just an overview of how the app environment works so that you can be able to do the next two apps we're going to make. but also start thinking about your own apps that you want to make, you'll be able to do that. Someone else need? You'll see on this handout, the first thing to do is to go to appinventor.mit.edu. And it will ask you, it needs Flash, so it should work on most devices. But if you're having trouble, let us know. We have backups.
Did you have backups?
You just go to that website, appinventor.mit.edu. This is the home screen or the home page that you will see there. Okay, this is the page, and there you can just go to create apps. Okay, create apps, and once you click the create apps button, it will ask you for a Google account. Okay, if you have a Gmail account, you can log in, or else the Wisk IDs, okay, our wisk.edu, actually they themselves are actually Google accounts. Okay, if you don't have a Gmail login, you can use your Wisk login, but you should give the entire thing. So my Wisk is Suseiraj, I'll give like Suseiraj@wisk.edu. So your Wisk account, you can log in.
Then it's good. We do not have any projects.
And if you ask, like, okay, can I allow this account to access App Inventor? You can. All these things, you can just continue or accept the terms and conditions and stuff like that. How many of you are able to log in into App Inventor? Everyone? Or how many of you are not? Okay, I think everyone. To log in. Okay, after going there, now, okay, before I like explain anything about this App Inventor, first let's just create a project, okay? Let's create a project, and then within the project, so you can go to the projects tab right here and go to start new project. And once you go to start new project, it will ask you for a name. So the app that we are going to develop right now is called Talk to Me. I'm just saying Talk to Me. This is the name of the project. And once I click enter, press enter or click OK, this screen comes up. So just make sure that everyone has this particular screen with a blank, like a phone screen on your website. Again, whenever you are struck, okay, if you are struck with anything or if you are like falling behind, just raise your hands and one of us will be there to help you out. And that's why we are here, okay? Four of us are here, one of us will be there to help you out, okay? And once you see this, okay, the screen that we have right here in the middle is our app screen. You can think of our app is going to look like this. As of now, we don't have anything here. It's just empty, okay? Even though we don't have anything here, first, what we are going to do is connect our tablet, whatever we have, with this particular App Inventor, this website, okay? And so, for doing that, what we are going to do is, you can take your tablets, okay, and you can take your tablets, and there will be an app in all the tablets. There is like an App Inventor app that is pre-installed for you. I can show you right here.
So come around. It might be.
So in your apps, in all your apps, there is this MIT AI2 companion.
Yeah,
MIT AI2 companion. It's like this. It's like this. And once you open that particular app, it shows something like this. It asks you to enter some 6-character code, okay? To find out the 6-character code, what we are going to do now is, in your computer, there is an option at the top, a menu item called Connect, okay? You can just say Connect, and you have like an AI companion. Do you see that? If you just click Connect, there is something called AI companion. And in this particular context, AI does not stand for artificial intelligence. It just stands for app inventor, okay? So it just says we are going to have like an app inventor companion, okay? And once you click that, the QR code comes up, okay? Once you click that particular AI companion, a QR code comes up, and immediately you can take your tablet, okay, and use the option of scan QR code, and just like take a picture of it. It automatically takes a picture. You can just say scan QR code and just keep it before that particular QR code. Automatically it connects the app to the website, and your phone are now connected, or like your computer and your phone are now connected. And you should be able to see something like this, in the sense your app's blank screen should appear there. Is everyone able to see it?
Yep.
Are we good?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then what is going to happen here is like, okay, we have so many things that we can do with the App Inventor. There are multiple, categories here. One such category is user interface, okay? If we want to have like a button, you can just like drag and drop a button here, okay? And if you see here, okay, a button comes here. Now this particular screen that we are seeing here is called the design view, okay? We can design how our app needs to be. So for example, if we are building like a map app, okay, we should have like a text box there for us to enter the source and the destination, right? From where should we go? And then we'll press something like get direction. That is like a command button. Right now we have a command button, something like this. So this is the view where we will actually understand how can we design our app, okay? It comes from our imagination. You can imagine whatever you want your app to be and then do something like this. But I'm just giving you a high-level overview that this is a designer view. And how can you understand that this is a designer view? Here, you can see this. Right now, this is disabled, which means that you are actually in the designer view. And if you want, you can now, there's one more view called the blocks view. You can actually, if you just click the blocks, you go to another view called the blocks view. And this is where all the fun is going to happen. I mean, this is where we will be writing a program, a computer program, to tell our app, okay, this is what you should do when this button is clicked, okay? So if you see in the blocks view on this side, on the left-hand side, we have the screen one, the screen that we saw there, the blank screen, and we have the button one. If you just click button one, it tells you what are all the blocks that are available with button one, something like this, okay? We'll be going through this in detail, but if you see here, when you just dragged and dropped the button, you should be able to see your button, that button that you just dragged and dropped on your app also. Okay. Did everyone see that? It just updates like online, like just like that. Okay? So just the introduction that we had right now, I'll just summarize it. In App Inventor, we have two views. The first view is a designer view, where we want to like have all the different components that we want to have in our app. We just like assemble them and lay them out in a way that we would like. And the second view is the blocks view, where we will be using some blocks to write the code for our app, code or a program for our app, okay? We'll be actually programming. And to get us started with our first app, now I'm handing it over to Kirtana to walk us through. And the idea for this first app, okay? We are going to show you the first app right now, okay, even before doing anything. So now we are connecting this particular app to the app inventor. And
okay.
Now Carolyn will show you like how this works, okay? What does this app do?
So this first app is pretty simple, but it's a lot of fun. So it has two buttons on it, and we hit the first button.
Hi, I'm Chitty the robot. Speed 1 terahertz. Memory 1 zettabyte. Hello world.
You can make the app talk to you like it's a robot, and you get to program exactly what you want to say. You can pick from a couple different accents. It's really funny. And then there's a text box where you can type something in. I'm going to type in, hi, app inventor.
So actually she's just typing in this text box right now, okay, in the app. Whatever we do there will not appear here, but whatever we do on the computer will appear.
Hi, app
inventor grid. Hi, app inventor grid.
So then you can type stuff in and make it say it back to you, which is actually a lot of fun. So we'll show you how to make these buttons, how to make the text field, and then how to add the code behind that does all these things. This is a very simple app. So we're going to start with Kirthana.
Stop shaking
me. Sad face. Oh, that's the second part. That too?
Did you listen to this? What just happened?
Stop shaking me.
Forgot about that part. Yeah, the final part is we're going to make it respond when you shake.
Stop shaking me.
So all these things are done in the simple app using some code behind it, which we are going to walk you through to help you guys like how to build such a thing. Okay, and my favorite part is this.
Stop shaking me.
Yeah.
Stop shaking me. Sad face.
Okay. Let's see how do we build this.
So I'm gonna start a new project so that you can all follow along with me. So you already saw there are drag buttons from the pane on the left hand side to your screen. And now we have the option to, you know, rename the button, or you have the option to control what text goes on the button. So right now it shows text for button one. So if you want to change that, all you have to do is go to the right-hand side of your screen, scroll down, and there you have an option called text. So you can replace it with anything you want. Like just say, let me call this about me. And press enter. And now if you, And now if you go and look at your button, it's gonna show about me. You guys get that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now comes the cool part. So when we click this about me, we are gonna make the app talk to us, right? So in order for the app to talk to us, we are gonna have to introduce a new component called text to speech. And to do that, you just go on the left pane and go down to media. And if you go to media, you can see a lot of options like camera, camcorder, player, sound. And then you see an option called text to speech. Just drag it and bring it on the screen. So when it's on the screen, you see that it's actually not on the screen, but below the screen, and it's labeled a non-visible component. That's because you don't actually see it on the screen, but it'll just be called whenever you click the button, or you can define the behavior as to when it has to be called. Okay? So now that we have it, we're going to make sure that when you click the button that says about me, the app says something. Okay? So shall we go ahead? Is anyone having trouble?
So right now, if you click the About Me button on your app, it will not do anything. It will not even respond to you at all, because we have not written the code for us to tell, okay, what should that button do, okay?
Right. We have it looks great in designer view, but we didn't put anything in code view yet.
Yeah. So in order to tell the app what it needs to do when you click the button, you need to go to the blocks view or the code view. And in your code view, again on your left hand side, you have a list of built-in components and your screen and the components which you've already placed in your screen. So there you can see that you've placed your button one and your text-to-speech component. So now, what should your app do? So how will you define this behavior? So when you click the button, you want the app to say something, right? So let's look for some property that says what you need to do when you click a button. So for that, you just click the button. And you see a lot of options here. So there's this first option called when button1.click do something, right? So we need this. So all you need to do is just drag it and drop it on the blocks view. Everyone following? So this is, we are just going to define what is going to happen when you click the button, okay? And so now when you click the button, you want the app to say something to you, right? So that is defined by the text-to-speech component. So now you go and click the text-to-speech component. And there you see a lot of options. And the one that we are particularly interested for this is this option called Speak. So when you call text-to-speech component, you can ask the app to say some message. So you just drag it and drop it here. So these components kind of fit together logically. So when you want, when you click the button, you want the app to say something. So for the app to say something, you need the text-to-speech component, which is why it's, you know, it's kind of locking onto the button component. Any problems? Are you guys following me? Cool. So now, we need to provide some text for the app to tell us when we click the button, right? So for that, you have this option called text, right? So just drag this first option, which is nothing but an empty text placeholder, to the message part. So these are all like logical pieces of the puzzle, and now you can see how they fit together. And so if you just hover over that, you just see a message called text string. So you can just go there and enter whatever text you want your app to say. So I've typed, "Hi, I'm your robot." So just do that and press enter. Just write, you can write any text that you want your app to say.
Your volume to be the maximum in your app. You want to hear whatever you guys have typed.
There should be some volume.
You can play around with that, add your own funny messages.
You trying to turn it back on?
Yeah.
It's a very deceptive
thing. Hi, the
doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, you can have it.
Whatever works. So cool.
How did you change the
shape? Yes, the narcissistic.
How was it, guys? Is it fun? Can I see your message?
Has everyone got this?
Hi, Muhammad, God of the Seven Kingdoms, hail to thee.
Alright, so congratulations, you all wrote an app. So we're going to add the next feature to this. Alright? And the next feature is another button and another text field. So if we want to add more things to what shows up on the screen, we remember we have to go back to the designer view first. So go back to the designer view. And we want to add another button. And we want to add another text box. Do you guys remember where on the left-hand side we find these user interface things? What menu option are they under? Buttons and text fields. They're user interfaces, so they're under user interface. There's a lot of menu options under here that you can look through to find what you need. We're gonna add another button. Another button, and we're gonna add a text box. All right.
But in this case, I don't like the fact that they're all stacking up on top of each other. I want the layout to look a little better. And so I can change the layout, not surprisingly, under the layout menu. And there's a couple different choices. If I drag over horizontal arrangement, it gives me a container I could put my things in so I can line them up the way I like. So the layout options allow you to change the way it laid out so it doesn't stack all on top of each other. All right, now we have a button and we have a text field. And we already have the non-visible component. We already have this text-to-speech down here, which is really our way of telling the tablet to activate that. There's so many things that it could use. The camera, the microphone, the accelerometer. It's not going to activate them all unless you ask it to. We already have this one activated, so we're ready to go. So the next thing we need to do is we need to program it, because it's there, but it doesn't do anything yet. So we go to the blocks view to add some code. And this one's going to be Malazzo. I think we can let you guys figure this next part out. You guys know how to find the button, code for a button, and the code for the text-to-speech, and we're going to have you try and look for how to add the message in that came from the text field. So this is a little bit of a challenge, but try to do the last part yourself, so be around if you get stuck, and then test it out if you think it works. So add the code to make the button say what was in the text field.
Just remember one thing, the computer or the computer is like very dumb, okay? And we as programmers should explicitly tell the computer using our program what it should do, okay? So if you think that, okay, it will understand just because a text box and a command button are side to side, no, it doesn't.
Remember, you want it to say the words that are in the text box. So you're probably looking for a box that's under the text box. That's where you're going to get all the code that lets you interact with the text box.
It doesn't want to get in.
If you found it out, just like raise your, if you have done it, just raise your hands and one of us will come to this check.
So, what it makes
sure I didn't get this in.
That's because it doesn't want to fit that one. So this one is the text box itself as a component. And that's not a thing it can say. You were really close. So under the text box, there should be one that is the text that was entered into the text box. No, it'll be the, you're looking for the text that was entered into the text box. So keep scrolling down. Not the height of the text box, not the numbers in it.
This one?
The text that was in the text box, yeah. Yeah, because the text box as an element can't be spoken.
Okay.
It was like the whole, like, the thing. So that's to try it out.
Good to test box, you're almost there.
Feel free to play around with all the options.
Find which one that will output the text. You read the text.
So, yeah. Oh.
Should be good.
You guys good?
Exactly.
Hi.
Ooh.
Not zip.
File dump.
Wait, I want to see something.
And you want not the text box.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's up,
slut? Shut up.
What's up, slut?
Are you guys like having like a war here with your text to speech?
And you'll get used to it once you're on the ASL. But yeah, that's it. Now you can try it out.
You know you can change the voice.
Emojis. You type emoji in your text box.
Hello, smile with orange.
Smile with a halo.
What?
You said you peed in your pants, right? You said you peed in your pants, right?
Okay.
It's like sad face.
Oh my god.
Where is the emoji?
This is nice though.
I wanna make this.
Are you excited for the
Doctor Strange
movie?
Yeah. Oh, there's no middle finger.
Does everyone have this?
The Marcus on this side?
Everyone's got this. Does everyone's got this part working? Alright, let's. We're gonna go on to the next part then. So on this, remember when you're looking for the blocks that affect a certain element, you always look for them over here, right? So everything to do with the button, you find on the button. Everything with the text box, you find on the text box. You might need to scroll a little bit, but there's also hints to help you find out what everything means. So if you're looking at all the stuff in our text box, you're like, I don't know what that means. If you float your mouse over for a moment, a box will come up to help you figure out what these different things are. And these should give you ideas on really cool stuff that you could do on your own beyond what we're going to be able to show you in just this short amount of time. So, Jarl's going to show us the next part, which is making it talk when you shake.
Making what?
Talk when you shake.
Oh, cool. Can I like, say ow when I drop the device?
What the... Oh, shit.
So yeah, if I shake this, the tablet right now, it doesn't do anything, right?
Uh-huh.
Even your tablets wouldn't react to the shake if you try doing it, okay? So can someone tell me where can we find this component? I'm going back to the designer view. Under which of these categories do you think that we can find a component that can respond to like shaking?
Sensor.
Sensors. Awesome. So just check that. We'll go to sensors. It's going to sense. There are so many sensors out here, like proximity sensor, orientation sensor, like accelerometer sensor. Which one do you think?
For shaking.
Yeah. Which one do you think that corresponds to shaking?
Accelerometer.
Accelerometer. Yep. So let's try the accelerometer sensor. Okay. So we have it here. Now, again, do you see it becoming one of the non-visible components? Because no one is going to like interact. The user is not going to interact with the accelerometer sensor like by typing it, by typing or like by pressing a button or something like that. But still, it is a component in your app which is not visible to the user. And so it is right here along with text-to-speech. Now, let's go to the blocks view. Okay, and in the blocks view, we have these two things already, and if you see here under your screen, under the horizontal, like under all these components, button 1, text to speech, you also have the accelerometer sensor component right here. So if you just click that, all the different code blocks that you can do with the accelerometer sensor just appears here. And can someone guess what is the block that we may need to make it like talk something when we are shaking?
Second one?
Second one, yeah. So when the accelerometer sensor is shaking, this is again an event handler. Here we are saying when this event happens, do something, okay? And again, for doing something, we want the app to like shout at the user, right? Whoever is having the app, or like to, what to say, cry or something like that. So if you want to do something, then where should you go again now? Yeah, again text-to-speech. Yeah, text-to-speech is so super useful here. And you again go to text-to-speech, and here you just say in the message, we are going to give a fixed message every time it shakes. So again, I go to text and use the double quotes where I can put in a fixed message.
So we'll come around to make sure you guys got this much.
And again, here also you can type some emojis. I just type an emoji here at the end, like a sad face, okay?
That's it. You're embarrassing me.
That's so bad, that's so bad.
Is this working?
Okay, I'm gonna do the innocent one.
Okay,
there
you go.
Oh my god, what happened?
Shake it off. Stop shaking me. No.
Shake it off. All right. We should.
All right. So that is your guys's first app. So this is a lot of fun. So yeah, you guys made an app. And it's a lot of fun, and it wasn't too hard, and it shows you how much fun programming and computer science can be. You can make really cool things that you can share with your friends. We're going to go start on the next one, which is we're going to be able to take pictures of our friends and be able to paint on them, which is really cool. Show you what that looks like. And then probably around 6:30 or so, we should have some pizza coming, which is very exciting. So we'll take a break when we get to that. So get the
What's the pedometer do? Wow, this is really cool.
Shake it off. And we made a canvas here that we can draw on. So you can pick a color and we can doodle on our friends. We can draw on them. We can change the size of the pen that we're drawing with. We can draw dots that are small or dots that are big. So we've got some different sliders here. So we have some different features we've added. And we can also take pictures of people. Alright. And then we can draw on the pictures. I'm giving you a green beard now. And then we'll be able to share these out by sending them to your social media accounts. So this is kind of like a fun Pictionary type game. So it looks like there's a lot of components there, but once you get the hang of it, it's pretty easy to build this type of app. So we're going to get started. If you want to do the first part, I can help fix whatever's wrong with this.
Go ahead and take this one first. I need your charger because it's like
dying.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The laptop or the tablet?
Laptop.
Laptop.
Wait, what are we supposed to do?
Just chill for now. They're gonna get started on you.
Let's talk. Yo, let's talk.
Okay, so I'm going to start the project.
Don't be mean, huh?
Second out.
Seriously, don't be mean. And then adjust your volume, not too loud.
You can change the accent too if you want.
How do we change it?
You gotta figure it out. That's the over there did it.
Really?
So now, first, we're gonna have to create a placeholder where we can draw or where we can bring our friends' images and where we can draw over that, right? So, do you guys have any idea where, under which category we can find that? So we have user interface, we have layout, we have media, we have drawing and animation, so many other stuff. So what are we going to do here? We're literally going to draw over some picture, right? So I think we should be able to find the component under drawing and animation. Yes. The component name is called a canvas. So a canvas is nothing but imagine a canvas on paper. So that's this canvas corresponds to the same thing on your mobile phone. So you just drag it, and you drop it on the screen, and you see a placeholder for the canvas being created. Everyone following me? Cool. So now, we want the canvas to be big, right? We want our friend's picture to at least, look good on the screen. So we're going to change the properties of the canvas and change its size so that it at least fills the screen, or at least half of the screen. So for that, we go to the properties of the canvas one, and there you can see options like background image, font size, height, width, etc. So the properties that we are interested in is height and width.
Canvas?
So let's go with width. We want the image to fill the entire width of the screen, right? So you have several options there called automatics, fill parent, pixels, and percentage. So what's the concept of parent here? So the canvas view is actually a child view of the empty screen that you saw initially when you began the app. So with respect to the empty screen, you want the canvas to occupy the entire width of the parent. Right? So in this option, you're just going to select fill pattern. And now,
you got it?
Yeah.
Click OK. And now you would see that the canvas is occupying the entire width of the pattern or the screen. And now we're just going to change the height to, let's just say, we want the image to at least fill half the screen. So we can just type in like 50%. Press OK, and now you see that your canvas is occupying the entire width of the screen and also half the height of the back. Everyone following me?
Is it width?
So you're looking for right width. You want good fill in the hair, the width. Yeah, say OK. There you go. Parent in this case is the whole screen. You could have a layout container that would be parent otherwise.
So now we're gonna look at the part where we're gonna draw something. So let's start with something simple as drawing a line. So as and when you drag your finger on the screen, you want a line to appear, right? So this will help us, draw our friends' faces probably. So to do that, we're going to have to add some code. So we go to the blocks view. And the component we're going to select is canvas. And yes, so you can scroll down and see a lot of options there. And then the particular option that we're looking for is canvas draw line. Okay? So let's drag that onto the screen. Okay, so to draw a line, just like in geometry, we need two set of points, right? The source and the destination, right? The starting point and the ending point. So for that, so that's x1, y1, x2, and y2. They're just xy coordinates, but instead on your mobile instead of Facebook. So to do that,
we thought you were going to need calculus.
We're going to again have to.
How can you make the buttons more beautiful?
The one is everyone's a little bit.
And like, if you want to download this app,
what?
That is a good question. You should ask.
Were you asking a question? No, I was waiting for a question. What? Can you repeat?
If you have like a really cool app you build using this and you want to make it more beautiful, so you can download. I'm not sure if you can download it. And if we can modify using the best version.
This is happening on the canvas, right? So we need to first define the behavior for the canvas and then instruct the canvas what to do when you draw a line. So for that, you have this option called pencanvas1.drag. So just drag it on your screen. So when you drag something or when you drag your finger over the canvas, you want to draw a line. That's what this says. Got it? And now, to draw the line, as I said earlier, you need two set of points. And that point is defined by... So when you draw a line, you have this... the line, the position where your finger is on the screen is defined by current X and current Y. And when you move, the new point becomes current X and current Y, and the previous point becomes previous X and previous Y. So your line should actually start from previous point and end at the current point, right? So all you need to do is just hover over previous X, and you get two options, get previous X and set previous X. So just click get previous X and plug it in here. The same way for previous Y. Hover, click, and drag. And now, for the ending point of the line, you get the coordinates from current X and current Y. So just hover over current X, drag it, and drop it. Same for current Y. And now,
so just to understand like whatever is happening here, okay, just to like make sure that what was happening there, assume like now, like let's assume this paper is the canvas that we have, okay, for drawing. If you just keep your hand somewhere like here and just start dragging your hand like till here, okay, then what happens is this point, according to App Inventor, where you just started, this is start X and start Y. And at the same time, this point where you are currently here is the current X and the current Y. Okay, this is the current X and the current Y. So what we are trying to do here is like draw a line from here to here. But if you remember, we did not use StatX that way, but we instead we used previous X and previous Y, okay? Why this is needed is, if you just use StatX and StatY, StatX and StatY is this fixed point, okay? And so from there, if you draw a line to current X and current Y, and then if you just move your hand from here to here, this line will not be drawn, but instead, lines will be drawn from here to here, like this. You understand? This is what will happen, and this will be so much fun. You should try this also, okay? And if you just have like lines drawn between StatX to current X, wherever you move your finger, from the point where you just started touching the canvas, lines will be drawn continuously, okay? But instead, if you want to like follow your finger wherever your finger goes, then it's simple. It's like now, if we move from here to here, this was previous X and previous Y, and the current position is current X and current Y. And then next, when we move from here to here, now this position, this point becomes previous X and previous Y, and wherever we are right now becomes current X and current Y. And this is the logic, okay? This is the logic behind whatever is happening there, or why are we choosing previous X, previous Y to current X and current Y. And so that changes like every fraction of a second, the previous X and current X changes, okay? And so if you think about this, see, now we are using geometry, okay? We are using like something like analytical geometry. So all, we'll be using like so many, our knowledge from so many different fields when we are actually programming. And we should understand this first before we actually do any code. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's the whole point here. So, and even the next topic, we'll also be looking like so many different things from mathematics that we'll be using. Okay.
So now if you go look at your app and see, you can just keep drawing lines, crazy lines, where you want. And one thing I would like to point out here is that you will not be able to draw beyond a certain point, because we've set the height to occupy 50% of the screen, if you remember. So I'm able to draw only to here. So which means this is the border of the canvas.
Only your canvas stops here. You can see that right here.
So that's the boundary of your canvas on the screen.
See, this is really...
Okay, erase.
Okay, erase
it.
So work on this, and then your challenge is make a button that clears the canvas.
How can you do
this? You should know all the components on how to make a button and how to get a button to interact with the canvas to clear it. So try that out. We'll come around to help you if it gets stuck. And then you can experiment with small pieces of canvas.
Now you can do it in any way. So for example, if you shake the apple, so you can erase it, right? Because you know how the app can respond when it shakes.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying that is one option, or you can have a button here called clear, and when you just click the button, you can erase it.
Okay.
There are multiple ways that you can do it. Yeah.
So yeah, really,
I saw you doing the thing, like the, what are those called, like the same, yes, exactly, and shake it and it goes away. How's it going? Are we clearing it? We're getting there?
Not yet.
Alright, you're on the path. There you go. Look at that. Now you gotta try it. You can also try it like a etch a sketch where you shake it and then it clears it. You remember the fun things that, yeah.
So I have to
see if you can. The stretch goal for you.
So
you have it. Let me see what you have on there.
Some other ways. So for example,
yeah.
Oh, so you're trying to do it where if you shake it, it clears? Perfect. Okay, so when it's shaking, now you want the canvas to do something, right? You want the canvas to clear. So instead of looking at the accelerometer sensor, since you already
did that, already got this, can you make your app respond to shake in a way like once you draw and once you shake your app, it should clear off the screen?
Like an Etch-a-Sketch?
Can you try that?
Exactly.
Once you shake your app like this, it should clear the screen off.
Justin just tried that, and I too tried that
when first time I was trying to program this.
Look at that!
And once you have done this, in the sense once you're ready and you're ready to move on to the next thing, you can try different features that you want on your own, whatever you would like.
I'm so proud of
me. Do like a button right now.
I want to show you all the different apps that they like. So they give out awards for awesome apps. Mm-hmm. Some guy created this game just using the app inventor.
This.
Yeah. And there's a 14-year-old kid who made like a math app for to help teach kids arithmetic with his like mom's like organization and stuff. Mm-hmm. Lots of fun stuff. So yeah, you can like create a game app. So yeah, you can definitely explore and see like all the fun stuff. Create an on focus workout app. You can apparently shake it and Exercise. So yeah, take a look. Ooh, fun. Yeah, there's a lot of fun stuff people have built. Shakespeare related. Oh, no, this one's Galileo. So five French students, 14 years old, wanted to prove that the sun is rotating around the earth, not vice versa. Their unique crowd sourcing app helps. There's a lot of crazy stuff. So yeah, so whatever you want to do, it's very robust.
Don't let the whole fun drag and drop fool you. I mean, it's amazing.
So we did that stop shaking, right? So maybe we do that. We should think about that.
Okay, now I'm going back to the previous project. I want to change the sound.
Now you should go back to the sensor. This is the shaking component here so that it comes here.
This is really cool. I can spend like my whole weekend developing all this shit. What's the password textbox? Cool. You can do your own password.
Yeah. So that was exactly what you're searching here.
Yeah.
Just one box.
Very
robust.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ed. I'm going to
draw a line. And then come back to the code view and then just code the component.
Have you ever, I'm sure you have, like looked at all the different, like, the fun apps that they give out awards, App of the Month awards.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the stuff is amazing. Like, I built that entire game off of it. There's like a crowdsourcing app. There's like an arm workout app. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like, such a robust tool for something so simple as this one.
Ooh, video player.
Design and installation of autonomous portable tape system. Wow. That's
How do I change the song?
What is this website? Where
It's actually App Inventor. App Inventor.
Oh, they have a link here?
Yeah.
Of the month? Okay.
App of the month.
Using App Inventor, they have developed all
the Okay. I just Google like App Inventor examples, and this is like the first link that popped up. So
great,
all
great,
these
great.
Crazy things. Communication. Yeah. It's crazy. I just got a demo from one of the PhD students, and he's doing like a chatbot that you can just basically put in very simple commands and it'll do machine learning tasks for you. So
but there's a Python code in it, like running in the background, but all you have to say is select, pick these features, and it'll like automatically try to transform it.
Yes,
we're gonna try to do like a tiny component of it that maybe that he can plug in later on. Super fun. And I was like, you should do it with like Amazon Alexa or something. It's like voice command. It would be like the kind of Tony Stark stuff you see in Iron Man, you know? Eventually we'll get there. But yeah, that was really, really cool. But this is what? This is like amazing. I wanted to play around and make some fun stuff.
Okay.
See if I can get Amazon.
How do I change the accent? Because I'm trying to figure it out.
So I think you should go to the text-to-speech component. First go back to the designer view.
Uh-huh.
Go to the text-to-speech component in the designer view. And it has some properties here.
So I'm just putting here.
No, you already had it, so you can delete this. You can just say delete. And you already have the text-to-speech component here. You see this?
Yeah,
here you have which country, language, speech, and the speech rate.
Okay. Thank you.
Which option are you looking at now?
It will be more fun even if you shake something, it can respond to you in a way like, okay, I am clearing the screen now. It can say something and then clear the screen.
You just want this function.
It's still the same.
And you want the app to speak something.
So
some
messages
that
are
messing
with
stuff
like
text.
Oh, okay,
right?
So I got like
colors,
I got like
different
colors.
I don't know what to do. The buttons and stuff that they probably are
supposed
to be.
Do you like it so far?
But we
took
so,
a measure.
This is what we're doing.
At least here, like, only one person is doing.
Okay. Yes. It's very easy to understand and think. So everything is all based on
eyes. Yeah. Well,
so when you drag your finger on the canvas, you want to draw the line, you need some coordinates, and that is defined by this.
What crazy thing are you trying now?
I'm trying to change the accent, but it seems to be the same for all of them.
Oh, interesting.
What's an obvious, like, different, distinguishable accent? Okay, you see, you can't my name, and then like, I'm putting like, okay, Australia,
mm-hmm.
Oh, wait, okay.
My name is Adam.
It doesn't sound like Australia.
You might have to type a whole paragraph.
I wonder if it's, I wonder what that actually does. Is there like a hover? Would you mind if I try?
So it looks like you guys all got this part working. So I'm going to give you a real quick preview of how to add color buttons. Some of you have already started doing this. And give you a few other hints. And then you'll have some more time to work on adding cool stuff to this.
Yeah.
So we want to be able to add a whole bunch of buttons.
Speak in this particular accent or something like that.
Add a whole bunch of buttons. Different colors, you can add as many as you want. Again, I don't like the way this looks. I want the layout to be different, so I just pick a different layout. And that gives me a layout box so I can put things inside. And I can change the name of the button, the text that's on the button over here. And I can change the background color. All right, so I have a nice red button that I've added a bunch of buttons. You guys know how to do this part. So now let me show you how to use that to change the canvas. Under the blocks view. So when I go here to change the canvas, the first thing I see is, well, which button am I working on? So the name like button one, button two, is really confusing. So I'm going to go back and fix that. In the designer view, the text that's on the button is what the user sees, but the name of the button is just for you to see. And here, I don't like button 1, button 2, button 3. That's just too confusing. So I'm going to pick this button, and I'm going to rename it red button. Just like I can rename this other button something else, this one will be the blue button. You can name it whatever you like, but name it something that's going to help you when you're back in the blocks view. So now when I go back to the blocks view, I can tell what button I want to work from, right? Because I've got blue button, red button.
Yep.
So this is really important that you name your elements in a way that's understandable. So now I want the red button to do something when I click it. I do that. I want it to do something at the canvas.
Absolutely.
So I go there and change the...
He hasn't signed up yet, but he just wants to try it out.
There we go.
No, you're on the radio. Yeah. Come on then.
I have a tablet here, actually, so I can move.
Canvas.
Do you have a laptop with you?
Right.
Snip.
Oh my God. Now when I do this, I can tell there's a problem. I'm not done yet. Not only because I'm a puzzle piece, but because I have a red triangle here. So if there's a problem with your code, there's some error that's going to make it not work right, you're going to get a red
triangle.
This will
kind of get you started in,
and if you
know,
float over, it'll say something.
So, yeah,
okay.
Can you help him?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Say something, right?
All right.
Oh, here it says.
So, yeah. Let's get you started by having internet access.
I was supposed to give you a warning. Anyway, the warning is that there's something wrong here. There's not a piece is missing. So I can pick out a color from the colors list.
All right.
Here. But the other cool thing is you see this here.
This particular website right here. If you Google like MIT App Inventor, it'll be the first one that pops up.
What's the horizontal?
All right. Now we have four buttons. That part's all easy. So I'm gonna show you one other trick. If you want four buttons, so you want 10 buttons, or you want 100 buttons, it might be kind of tedious to keep dragging that over, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to show you a shortcut on how to create duplicates.
Yeah, so log in with your regular Gmail.
And that shortcut is if you right-click on it, you see there's a duplicate option.
Feel like you wouldn't grant.
Now I can add code for blue button, and I just go to this drop-down, change it to right, change it to blue button. Right now there's a red triangle. Why is it an error?
All right. So
why is it giving
project?
Me an error?
You can name it whatever you want.
You have two of them? Because I have two of them. And it says, I don't know what you want me to do when the red button's clicked. You've told me to
do
two things.
So
that's
this
really
is what
confusing.
Well, first of all,
so
I'm Erica.
I can just change the blue button.
Nice to meet you.
And there,
so
it's not,
what it basically
it's not mad
does
at me anymore.
Is as you build things up, is a
right-click to
kind of
duplicate,
drag and drop mechanism. So you don't actually have to type any code, which is cool.
It'll
and
give
then
you that red triangle if there's an error
tablet.
Message.
And as you build things, it'll automatically
so
update and contest things out as it goes.
You guys
right?
can now go and
so,
make as many color buttons as you like.
You
be sure to rename the buttons of a designer view so you can easily find them in the blocks view. And you can duplicate the code if it makes it faster to add more color buttons. Alright, so give you some time to add more color buttons and color features, and then we'll add the next feature, some sliders after that.
You can add more colors than the standard ones. See if you can figure out how to like do that, adjusting the RGB like combination. It's pretty sweet. Lovely.
Yeah, blue, green, what else?
Okay. So,
Okay, this
grab that tablet and unplug it from the.
Okay.
You're right first.
Oh,
I know
that works too.
Like,
and then,
are you serious?
If you just point it, it'll
automatically
get the picture. I know everything about
so basically, whatever you put in here is reflective.
No, I don't know.
All right, so let's do the fun one.
Why should I know?
Where it basically yells at me. So these are all the different like components you can add to it, and then once you move to the blocks view, that's where you can like put the actual code for all the different components to do something. Obviously, it's blank right now. So we're gonna start with a very simple thing called the button. So you basically drag and drop it, and you can rename the button itself. Going down on the properties of the button. So, next right there. So you can call it like about me. So you're basically gonna get a robot. Make a robot.
Cool.
Okay.
for the harder to read.
So you can see that immediately it updated to about me, which is pretty sweet. You can actually change the arrangement if it bothers you, if you go to layout. These are some of the ways that you can kind of get it to move around. So once you add more things, we can get it around with that. But let me get you started on like getting the button to do something. So right now if you click on it, it does nothing. So now we gotta add code to it, right? So go to the blocks. So these are all the things that you can basically add in terms of functionality. So you can see right here, you already added a button. So when you click on the button, so drag it and drop it in, you want it to say something, right? So then we bounce back to the designer. And let's try media. And there's this component called text-to-speech. So if you drag it and drop it, obviously it's an invisible thing, so it goes into the bottom. But now we can actually use it to say things. So go to the box again.
But if you want to draw...
And click on that. So basically this component right here says, when I click on something, call that particular text-to-speech thing and then say something. That's what that code component does, which is cool. Now we have to fit one more plus on it, which is actually get to say something. So these are some of the static things you can use. Text obviously seems to make sense. So if you click on that, this right here, just a quotation mark, you can fill it in with whatever you want. So drag it and drop it in there. And you can just type, hello, my name is robot, or whatever you want to put in there. Yep. All right, so then now you can do the honors. Click on the button.
Oh, but it's really tedious.
Hello, world.
I'm probably just lagging.
Really tedious.
Hello, world.
Exactly. Yeah, so now we can get it to... Let's do the fun part. Now you're gonna. What I'm gonna have you do is actually add a text box, and then when you press the button, you want the machine to read whatever you had entered off to you. Okay? So, what you need, you had a button, right? Well, now you probably need a text box because you want a text box, right?
Red, blue, green,
so let's see. This is actually a good place. Let's go to the layout. Let's try horizontal and vertical.
Yeah,
drop a box in there, and then try to drag that into the box, and then that into the box, and this, so it kind of aligns it that way. Yeah. All right, so now we're going to add another button so that it actually reads off of whatever you have
and then
in the
it doesn't show up.
So.
What should I do?
You have to call.
No, well, you gotta add a button first. You gotta add a second button so that when you click on a button right here, it'll read off whatever.
I know, but
then
you have to translate.
So go back to the design view. Button is under user interface because obviously people interface with it. You can add it right there.
Me, my camera after picture.
You can like change the text if you want to read me or something. So right here. All right, now we have everything we basically need. So go back to
the
coding.
Media, yes. Something in there.
All right, so see if you can figure out. It basically, you can cheat off of this. So when you click this button, you want it to say something, and you want to say whatever's in the text box, right? So see if you can figure that out. No, you still want that one to function. I don't think there's a copy, is there? Oh, duplicate. All right, I like it. Nice. So, good choice. So, just to see if you can scroll down. If you hover over them, it'll tell you kind of what it does. So, a hint is you want a piece that fits right in here. So, it's going to be one of these puzzle pieces.
I'm not sure. I'm going to try first. Thank you.
All right, now test it out.
Ooh, nice. Huh?
Yeah, now the final thing is right now, if you shake this, it doesn't do anything. You can get it to say something, like yell at you to stop shaking it once you start shaking it. So, go back to the designer block. Collapse the user interface. Okay, apparently you can't. Just scroll down. Which one of these buckets do you think decides? Exactly.
Oh, I
so,
think...
I think you have to let go.
Obviously, it's an invisible thing, but now that you have it, you basically go back to the block and see if you can figure out a way. When you shake the accelerometer, yeah, you want to say something, right? Yeah.
Right, so if I went here and I
yep, and you can get it to say whatever you want to say. Well, we're going to keep it static. So cheat off of that box. Exactly.
Red,
so now, try shaking it. So yeah, that was the very first part. Now, do you want to try making the app that lets you draw on pictures and take pictures and stuff like that?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, let's try that one. Okay, now we're going to create a brand new project. So we'll get projects, share a new project, and you can call this Canvas or whatever you really want to call it.
Okay.
Think for a little bit. And now, what should we do next? I guess it's already synced up, actually. So yeah, it's a blank screen. All right, so the first thing we're going to add is basically a blank canvas because you can actually draw on it, right? Yeah. And since it's so tiny, you can use the height and the width right here to kind of thumb that, yeah. You can do it by pixel, you can do it by percentage of the screen, so percentage probably makes more sense. That's the height, so you can fill it up like 50% or something. And the width.
Oh, I do.
Exactly. Perfect. Alright, now we're going to be able to...
Actually, scroll up for me. Do go to connect. Yeah, click on that. You can't
even click on that.
Maybe it's because it's blank. That's okay. No. Hold on. I need to check to make sure you are actually.
Yeah. Nope, it doesn't do anything.
Alright, I think we're hit on that. Alright, now we're gonna try to draw things on here, okay? You ready? Go to the blocks. Let's go, yep, click on canvas.
Go crazy, 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 see the
so. Well, you want it to be able to drag, right? Yeah, so see if you can find the. Yeah, exactly. When you start dragging it, you want to draw a line. So open that up again. Scroll down. Go up a little bit. Yeah.
Alright, thank you.
Going. You have a draw circle and a draw line. Oh. Which one do you want? Yeah.
Oh.
Exactly. So this is the part that they were talking about real quick. This X. This is your X, this is your Y. This point right here, and you're basically going to try to
yes,
this is X1.
Is everyone, was everyone able to get the color buttons working? The different color buttons working? Okay.
So now, as you drag your thumb,
now you are going to tell me, okay, how can we, did you guys remember, you saw some sliders out there? Where
right
if
here,
you move the sliders, you can increase
point.
The thickness of the pens
basically,
that you're drawing with, okay? So before we even start working on that, how many of you here know what a variable is?
Exactly.
What is a variable?
That's perfectly fine.
Do you guys have any idea?
For Y1.
Some of you are in 302, exactly. So I know you know what a variable is.
Did you right click on it? There we go.
What is a variable?
Oh,
yeah.
You can duplicate it. Oh, let's not do that.
So it just stores some information. The answer was like in math problems, you can have like some variables which can take some values at certain times, but values can change. In our real world, okay, what are some examples for variables? So let's assume.
I started here.
Okay,
exactly.
The date that we are in.
All right.
Currently, today is like November 3rd. 2016.
Okay. So there's no...
Is this a constant or is this a variable? I mean, tomorrow the date is going to change, okay?
Right,
so it is going to change, and even just
it,
the year.
I
right now we are in 2016,
right.
And in like
so
a few months, in like 2 months, we will be in 2017. So the value of the year changes, okay? And so year is also a variable. In the same way, in computer science, we use this, the idea of variables is like so like important and it's used like almost everywhere, okay? We create some variables and we just use those variables to, like what to say, in our programs to control some things. So why am I talking about variables right now is, if you remember the slider, okay? If you remember the slider which we use to like move or change the thickness of the line that we're drawing, if
allows you to change colors,
the,
but I'm gonna
what to say,
if
that
catch up to him,
button in the center of the slider is on the right hand side of the slider, it means that variable has a value, like a maximum value. So thickness is like big. But if the same thing, if it is at the leftmost end, then it means the thickness has reduced, okay? And it is at some different value, okay? That's why we are talking about variables here.
So that's what he's gonna
now let's see. First, can someone tell me where should we look for the sliders? Like in which component? Will it be under sensors or will it be under user interface? User interface, because user is going to interact with that particular component. And if I drag and drop a slider here, will
it
be on the screen or will it be a non-visible component?
Probably.
On the screen, it's because the user is going to interact. So first I'm going to user interface, and then I'm searching for a slider. The slider is here. I'm just dragging and dropping the slider here. Okay?
Oh, there we go.
You see the slider here, but it's like really small,
so
right? How can we make the slider like go to the entire width of the screen? How can we do that?
Yeah.
Any idea?
Bam.
We already did that for canvas, do you remember?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, just go to the properties of the slider and just change the width of the slider. So right now this is automatic, and since the slider is present inside the screen, okay, the parent component for this slider is the screen. Okay?
You
can think of the screen should be a parent and the slider is inside that screen. So the slider is like a child of the parent, okay? The child of the screen. So I'm just saying the width is going
to
be filled the parent. So whatever the parent's width is, just be the entire width. So the parent's width is the entire screen. And once I do this, you see the slider becoming big. Like it covers the entire width of the screen. Yeah. And then, now we go back to the blocks view, okay?
See,
and we can see our slider
here.
You see the slider here?
You need something
as one of
like
the components here. And once you click the slider,
so scroll down.
There are so many things here, but the main thing that we need here is that event, okay? We want to now sense that event whenever the slider's position changes. And you can see right here, says when the slider 1.position changed, okay? And I'm going to just drag and drop this particular event handler here, okay? You have this. When the slider 1's position changed, what should we do, okay? Can someone guess, or like based on you guys seeing there, can someone tell me what should we do? So the idea here is like whenever we move the slider, we want the pen's thickness to either increase or decrease. If we move the slider towards the right, the pen's thickness should increase, or the line that we are drawing, that line's thickness should increase. And if we move the slider to the left, the line's thickness should decrease. Can someone guess what should come here? Like what should be the code that should come inside this do? Maybe I'm not going to do that right now, you guys should figure this out, okay? What should we do, okay? Do what should be the block here to change the line that we are drawing, to change the thickness of the line that we are drawing? Or any guess like where could we find that particular block to change the thickness of the line that we are drawing? Where are we drawing the line? On which component are we drawing this? Very good. We are drawing the line on the canvas. So the immediate choice would be you can just go to canvas and see and search for if there is anything related to the line width, yeah, related to the line width that we are drawing on the canvas. Did you guys find it out? So here in the canvas, okay, in the canvas there are multiple things here,
so you can
and one such
so
thing you see here, okay, one such thing is the line width, okay, canvas one dot line width, and for all the different properties that are related to the canvas, we have two things here. One is like a get line width, and one is the set line width. Get will just give you the answer, I mean, will tell you, okay, the line width that you have currently is 10 or some number, okay? But set line width will actually make you, okay, set that particular value. You can say, now I want the line width to be 20. Okay, so what is the thing that we need now? Do we need a get or a set for the line width? Anyone? Should we get the line width or should we set the line width? Again, line width here is again a variable, okay? It can vary. Pardon? Set. So we are going to use set because we are going to set the width of the line based on the slider, right? Based on where are we at in the slider. Are we at towards the right or are we towards the left? Very good. So here I'm just going to use a set canvas1.lineWidth. Just going to use it inside here, but now how can I set this particular thing?
Okay,
it says line width 2. I have to fill in something here, right? What should I fill in here?
Okay,
what is
so now? What are you gonna do?
Thumb position, very good. The block itself gives you a hint right here. It says for this slider, wherever your thumb is, okay, you may use any finger, okay, you may use an index finger, anything like this on the slider, but it just says that particular thing on the slider to be the thumb of the slider. Wherever your that thumb is on the slider, it will just get that particular value, okay? So let's see here. I just keep my mouse pointer on this, and there is something like, again, you can either set the thumb position or get the thumb position. Now, should we set or get? Thumb position just tells us where in the slider are we. You can think of the slider to be, let's say, from 0 to 10, okay? If we are on the rightmost side, thumb position will be 10. And if we are on the leftmost side, thumb position will be 0. So now, do we need to use, now should we use get or set? Get, very good. So we just want to get that particular thumb position from the slider and use it to be the line width. That's it. Now let's see if this works. Okay? And this part where we are actually writing some code and then going back to check if that is working, this particular process in programming is called testing your program, okay? We're actually testing if our program is working.
To flip it around.
So here, again, you draw a line, and now you try changing the line width. You see this?
You see.
The line width has become so big, you can even decrease the line width.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you see here, that now if I decrease it, the minimum thickness is this. Do you see this? The minimum thickness is this. Can someone tell me how can we change this? And the maximum is like this. Maximum is okay, it looks good, but I want the minimum to be like even much lesser than this. I mean, I don't need it to be so thick to be the minimum thickness. Can someone tell me, like, how can we change this? I want to decrease the minimum line width to be even lesser or even thinner than this. How can we do that? Because we have no control as of now. We have no control over the thumb position, right? We just get that thumb position and we are just using it. Can someone find it out? How can we decrease the line width? Pardon? Very good. So the idea here is, what she just told now was just change the minimum value of the slider in the designer view. So now we switch back to designer view again. For the slider component, if you see on the properties, the max value is 50 and the min value is 10. Okay, so min value 10 is not ideal for us, so I'm going to change that min value to 1. Okay, and once I change that min value to 1, now if I try drawing this, when I am on the leftmost side, do you see the line now, line thickness now? It's much thinner than whatever we had previously.
The color of the...
And so, the slider in this particular component uses the ideas of variables, okay, to have. Okay, slider itself is a variable here. The component itself uses variables. It has a minimum value, at this time it is 1, and it has a maximum value, which is 50. You can even change the maximum value to even draw much bigger lines. And we used the idea of variables where we just got the variable's value, which is a thumb position, to set another variable called the line width, okay? And with this simple example, we can easily see how much like variables will be used in computer science. So, at a very high level, variables are something that can store some value, but that value, we can change that value whenever we need. Okay? In the program, we can change that value whenever we need. And this is how, we create sliders. Now, the challenge task here is, can you guys make your program draw some dots whenever you just touch the screen? As you showed before, you should be able to, whenever you just touch the screen, you should be able to draw some dots, okay? And then you should create one more slider to change the radius of the dot. Okay, the radius or the diameter, the radius of the dot should change based on the other slider that you are creating. Let's see if you can do this. First, try completing this, and then you can see, try the dots thing. Okay? If you're stuck with this, please let us know. We'll be around. And if you need any help with getting the dots working also, please just raise your hands and one of us will be there to help you. Challenge task again is whenever you touch your screen, there should be some dots in the same color, whichever color is selected, and
radius,
you should be able to create
question.
One more slider to change the radius of the dots.
What do you set the radius to? Why don't you try setting it to whatever the slider value is?
Set it back.
How do I make it?
I like it.
Did you draw a point?
You're getting fancy. All right. Try it. When you touch on it, now the next challenge for you is when you touch on it, see if you can get it to draw a dot where up. So right now you're dragging it, right?
Yep.
clear this for you.
Even though it only takes a few days, for
So the reason this is airing out is because they can't find exactly.
Yeah.
Yes. Now you can now add buttons to change the colors of the dots slash. So it's kind of has a dot instead of like a straight line, which is interesting. Draw a circle. It's like so try to add buttons that you can so that you change the color of your pen. You're on it.
Long.
You have to play the background. So what you need to do is put a finger. They're going to too light. So you won't be devastated when your image starts.
Pizza, sodas, and salads, both vegetarian and not. So if you want to get some, be careful about, make sure you don't spill the soda at your table, of course. So we're going to take about a 15-minute break or so to eat. And then when we come back, we are going to look at how to add the camera feature, how to share on social media, and we'll have some mentors from the CS classes come in and talk about some of the CS classes. If you were thinking about taking a class and you weren't sure which one to take, we'll have some people come and talk about that. But for now, let's eat.
Too many things.
This is complete. You said how ambient.
Yeah, there are like cheese pizzas and a vegetarian pizza and like pepperoni pizza.
What is mutton pie?
How's it going?
How much ever you want.
I've been loving him. This one? Is it?
And we may start from here.
Not sure what this is.
Yeah.
You're
just going to play like there are like salads.
You know RGB colors? Like it's a mix of red, green, and blue, and it can create any color you want it to. That's what that is. If you want to look at the guy in the red shirts example, he's basically created a slider where you can change the RGB values, and then you can get it to be any color you want. Oh, interesting.
Oh, you changed it again.
So, yeah. See, yes. Take a look at his example to see, like, how you might be able to reverse engineer it. Pizza!
You want to get some pizza?
Have you done any fancy stuff?
No,
it's
really.
Very fancy. Snap, I like it.
Yeah.
you got an eraser going. That's awesome. Can I try it?
Yeah.
Wait, so how does this work? So if I press, we can make an eraser like... Oh, you want to do that?
Yeah, we just put it like...
Basically, it's a pencil, but it's just white.
Oh, you make it a really thick one, so you don't have to, like, draw it in.
I think all the apps are like that. I think all the erasers are actually white in computers.
Yeah, do you realize?
Oh my god, my life is...
useful.
It's all been a lie.
Eat lah. I know you're getting into this, but...
I know, I'm so excited. I'm gonna change my major. Okay, then.
So quick, huh? What do you want to change? Like, that one is cool.
I was telling everybody, whatever app you develop here, you can actually load it up to Google Play, and you can have actually download it onto your phone. And there are a lot of cool different apps if you just Google like App Inventor. So this is a tool developed by MIT, and it's called App Inventor. So if you just Google App Inventor examples, there are a lot of really cool apps that people have made. There's like a car dashboard one, so as you're moving it measures like how fast you're going and weird stuff like that.
This is light.
I'm so glad I came.
Like in the first 5 minutes you always say,
okay, bye. I know. It's so amazing.
Are you a computer science or engineering student?
I'm a computer science.
Which year?
I'm a freshman.
You like it?
Yeah.
Good. Have you done like a full-fledged app development before?
No, I haven't.
If you actually try it. So Google has like an app development studio that has all the different APIs and codes that you can actually do it. Obviously it's not as like fun as this, but it's a very similar idea. It's like you have a listener that once you do a certain action, it basically responds. So it's just very modular and codes more or less like this.
What's it called?
I think it's just literally called Google...
Is that a lot
development
of pizzas and salad?
Like,
feel free,
Android,
don't feel shy to take more,
like
okay? Feel free to eat how much ever you want, okay?
But how do you change the way people just want specific...
Yeah, make sure you have some food too.
Just do it.
If you haven't eaten yet.
Oh. Oh, you did that.
Make it bigger lah, the eraser. The width of the color. Or maybe, is it, does it respond to this? Is it?
Is this applicable for iPhone?
Maybe that's just the only issue that we have.
iPhone is place wall. Samsung is place wall. iPhone?
iPhone is app store.
Oh.
Yeah, it's kind of sucks.
Sweet. So, you, like, if you click this, it's not going to change this value.
No, you have to change it.
Oh, I see. What does choose mean?
So, do this.
Oh, and then I choose. I like it.
Where from Korea are you?
Seoul.
I live in Incheon and Ma time.
Yeah.
My parents are from Mathon, so they still live.
Huh? Until about 2005.
Mm-hmm. Going back next May.
Yeah.
If you just like search for Android app development, Google itself provides all these tutorials.
This sound, music.
So instead of using like a GUI base, you'll actually type it up using Java and.
I can use Java.
It's Java based. The actual code itself and like the formatting is HTML CSS based, I think. So it's almost like coding a website. But you have the structure, the HTML document to basically align everything and give it the format. And then I think it uses Java, I'm pretty sure last time I tried it, to actually react to whatever you're trying to do. So it's fun. Highly recommend it.
So what is it?
Mm-hmm. So you can just click like this one right there. So it'll make basically download, I think, the actual studio, which is like an IDE, like Eclipse, basically, like your own.
Oh, yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. So you can download it, and you basically code off of it. And there are a lot of free tutorials that you can just follow along to.
Yeah, it's like an actual...
development environment, exactly. Okay. Not a GUI-based one like we've been using. But yeah, the high-level idea is very similar. You have variables, you have triggers. You code in like an object-oriented manner. You're taking 302 right now, or have taken it, correct?
Huh?
Have you taken 302?
I'm taking 302 right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So yeah. Once you take 302, you can totally do app development.
Me and some other guys are actually trying.
Do you have one?
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. What kind of app?
This will show.
Oh, what?
Again.
Okay.
Twitter. What do you want to do?
You can do the Android one, and somebody else can do the iOS one. Do you play board games at all?
I do, I like board games.
Okay. Another pretty big thing that's up and coming, I think, is board games that actually interface with like an app. So the app prompts you to do different things, like especially if it's like an exploration thing, like you put on another tile and it tells you what kind of monsters kind of appear or whatnot. So that's another thing you can look into. Not just like a game on its own, but something that interfaces with the board game.
Oh, it's like a mobile app game. Mm-hmm. It's like a board game inside
of it. Yeah, exactly. It's basically another component of a board game. Have you played Mansion of Madness?
No.
Descent.
All right. You guys can keep eating, but I want to show you guys how to use the camera. And you guys can keep
Monopoly. There's plenty of pizza and salad. I'm going to show you guys how to use the camera to take a picture of your friend since you can doodle on them. Because that's a lot of fun. So back in the designer view, if I want the camera, where are you guys going to guess I'm going to find the camera?
Oh, you already did this part.
Under media, right. There's a bunch of cool things under media. And I drag it. It's a non-visible component. Okay? Which means I'm just activating the camera. If I want to actually interact with it, I'm going to need a button. So I add a button. And I'm going to name this button, take a picture. And I go to blocks. All right. Now, some of this is going to be pretty straightforward for you guys. Like, if I want to do something, I want when I hit the button, I want the camera to do a thing. So I start on the button. And I say, oh, I didn't rename this button, did I?
You're just gonna do real app development now.
Oh, yeah. Already?
And jump into it.
Are you liking it? I was actually thinking about doing it before, so I was like,
oh, I can't name it. Never mind.
Crazy.
But yeah, I mean, the basic concept is that
there's camera. When camera button is clicked, I want it to make the camera do a thing, so I go to camera and I see camera take picture, right? That's pretty straightforward. Hit the button, the camera's going to take a picture. Now the camera took a picture, but it's just kind of holding on to it. So if I want the picture to show up on the canvas, then I need to take add some more code. So here I go back to camera and I see there's a block that says when camera after picture. So that said, okay, you took a picture for me. After that, I want you to actually do something with this picture. And I want to do something to the canvas, so I go to canvas, and I find a block, right? And I bet you guys could probably guess, but I'm gonna grab it here. Change background image to, and again, I got this red triangle. I click on it, and it says there's an error. You're missing something. I need to change to something. What I wanted to change to is the image that the camera took, which the camera's holding on to right here. So I'll hover my mouse and grab the image. So this is pretty straightforward. When you click the camera button, camera take a picture. When the camera's done taking a picture, give it to the background, the canvas background image. And that should work.
Is this yours?
Yeah, that's all there is to it. So you guys can try that and try out doing other cool things with the camera and try doodling on each other's faces.
Cool.
So
you like it?
You did all the hard work.
So what's your dissertation, or what's your research, or what's your project about? An opportune time to ask questions.
So we're gonna give you guys a couple minutes to try that out, and then when you're ready, we will show you how to share that.
I uploaded this, the music, but then I don't know where the music goes. My battery is dying.
Are you going back to the
store?
Are you?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to the gym.
In 2 days, I skipped gym. Strength. Okay. She's wearing the same shirt as me.
Well, we're almost ready.
Okay. So
Oh,
dancing.
Cool.
Deco.
Yeah, tonight.
You need to tell each and everything you wanted to do.
You can tell it to do whatever you want.
People are still eating. That's fine.
I have a question.
Sure.
I uploaded a music file here, but I don't know where it goes, where it's gone to.
You uploaded a music file to App Inventor?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, so we don't see it.
No, I don't know where it is.
That's a good question. It's not Sound 1.
I don't know.
Let's look at the other. Procedures. You may also need to put in a. Do you have a thing that plays music as a non-visible component? Yeah. So let's do. So probably you'll need like a button. When the button is pushed, you do player one dot start or something, right? Or maybe change source to.
I thought this file supposed to be the catch files.
Oh, there's your file that you uploaded.
Oh no,
maybe.
Yeah, probably the users when.
Oh, okay, but it's not the one that you save. So you, what you'll need is, how are you going to activate, how do you want to activate the sound in the first place? Do you want it to be a button?
The button?
You want to hit a button and then have the sound play?
Yeah.
So make sure you get a button.
So you actually have
to one button to click. Then try having your player
start.
Maybe start and then change source to.
Yeah.
Source sounds like it's important, right? Because it needs to know where the file comes from.
That is awesome.
So yeah, I try set player source.
Yeah, because you need to.
And then see if you can make the file be the source. File one. Grab the whole file. See if that'll allow you to snap it in.
Yeah,
maybe?
I learned how to use Vim effectively, so I went and did that.
So let's go throw that away. Let's go back to the player. And on these, just float your mouse over to get descriptions of what they are to find the one that lets you access a file. Like, if you wait a moment, there you go, there'll be a.
Super.
I should have like a.
Yeah.
Explanation. Okay, that one has one. Some of them don't have reports for the media.